Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 12 of Powerline Podcast. My name is Ryan Lucas, and today's guest is Jim Martin. Now, Jim's one of those people that every time I talk to Jim, I learn something new. He's an incredibly brilliant man with a lifetime of experience in the industry. His background is multi-layered, but has an emphasis on ergonomics and how it relates to safety. Today's conversation is about human performance, and particularly the effect that human performance has on the safety within the line trade. This episode will it'll change the way that you view safety, and I'm super excited to share it with you. There's tons of great content in this conversation, and this is definitely one of those conversations that everybody in this trade needs to hear, right from the line worker all the way up to upper management. Doesn't matter who you are, you should probably have a listen to this because you're going to come away with it just a little bit changed. So I'm asking that you guys please do me a favor and go into whatever podcasting app it is that you listen, whatever app that you listen to this show on. Can you please rate the show, leave a comment, and also pass this show along to everybody or anyone that you think may benefit from its content. Also, while you're listening to the show, please take a screenshot of it and post it to Instagram stories. If you're on Instagram, post it to Instagram stories, tag me in it, leave a comment on top of it. Tell me what it is that you liked or disliked about the episode or what part really touched you or got to you the most on it. And this really helps give me an understanding if I'm on the right track with getting you guys that kind of content that you guys want to hear and that's benefiting you. So without further ado, let's get into episode 12 with Jim Martin. Jim Martin, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you for having me.
It's great to have you here. I've been excited about this conversation for a while because you're an incredibly smart man and I learn something from you every time I talk to you. So what we're going to talk about today is human performance and the line trade. But before we get into talking about that, why don't you tell everybody where you're from and how you got into this trade?
Well, I'm from the Ottawa Valley, I guess, is probably the best description. In Ontario, I spent my youth, I was born in Ottawa, I grew up in the Ottawa Valley. Spent most of my time on farms until I was 18, 19. Went to university, studied psychology, got into the medical field for a period of time in the technological field, and then went back to school, did a degree in human kinetics, and through some contacts there, got involved in the ergonomics program and through one of our professors there, and kind of really got interested in the ergonomics field. And because of that, I had some contacts in Ontario Hydro who were just starting up an ergonomics program and back in the early 1980s. And so they hired me to come in and be a part of the ergonomics team. Excuse me.
Maybe explain a little bit what ergonomics is.
Absolutely. So certainly at that time, ergonomics was brand new. Nobody had really heard of it. And even up until now, 35 odd years later, a lot of people still haven't heard a lot about it. It has evolved. But ergonomics is really the science of optimizing the relationship between people and their work environment. Okay. That's probably the best way to put it. It involves a variety of subject areas such as engineering, human biology, human anatomy, physiology, you know, making sure that, you know, there's a thorough understanding of the human system, and what makes us tick, right? And so as an ergonomist, my role initially with Ontario Hydro was to work with our power line technicians, the line trade function, to look at some of the problems they had. And the reason was because back at that time, we were having multiple fatalities every year with the line trade. four or five, sometimes six or seven fatalities in a year. And there was a major initiative to change that, to basically stop fatalities from occurring. And it became a primary focus. One of the areas that it initiated out of was something called system safety. And the system safety initiative that was part of kind of the space and nuclear industries in North America. And ergonomics and human factors was a key component of that, and particularly as it was associated with human performance-related issues. So as far back as the late 70s and early 80s, I've been involved with human performance-related issues associated with the lion trade.
Okay. This is interesting. So issues around... What are the issues around human performance?
Right. So one of the reasons I wanted to talk about human performance today is because it's become a really huge topic in not just in the line trade, but in industry in general.
Yeah.
And what is really driving that is a number of things have evolved over the last 30 or 40 years. And one of those is a recognition that human performance, human error, is a major contributor to events. Having said that, one of the things that needs to be understood is why. And what are these initiatives today, these days about? What are the expectations and requirements? And from my experience, the whole concept of human performance, human error, kind of evolved largely out of the nuclear industry back in the late 1980s, early 1990s. And there's an author by the name of James Reason who wrote a book called Human Error. It was published in 1990. And that book kind of became a focal point for a lot of key initiatives around human performance improvement. Reason defined some really interesting concepts. And one of the things that he said was, human error is predictable. People will make mistakes, and we can predict when people will make those mistakes. He established some models around different performance modes, and that really started to catch on within some industries at the time. A lot of the incidents that were being investigated also at that time were identifying human error as the root cause of a lot of incidents. So over the next probably 15 to 20 years, a lot of emphasis was placed on the issue of what role human error plays in incidents. How does it evolve within the system? And what's really happened over the last probably 20 years is there's been an evolution around on two kind of different paths. One of them being that people are the problem. The other being that system is the problem.
Right.
And so the focus that I've always had, even as far back as the 80s, and because I'm an ergonomist and because my focus is on understanding humans and realizing that we are who we are, we've evolved these systems. We've created these complex systems. Mm-hmm. And so the problem isn't us per se. It's the systems we develop and create and the incompatibilities that sometimes exist between them. So if you look at the lion trade, and you know, so we were focused on the lion trade, and our biggest problems at that time were electrical contact, not surprisingly.
Okay.
Falls.
Yeah.
And a lot of the times the falls were as a result of an electrical contact initiated, and then motor vehicle accidents, because obviously the lion trade spends a lot of time exposed to those three hazards. And
how would you get to the point of predicting or thinking that you could predict an incident?
Well, that's an excellent question. And so what we put a lot of time and effort into our investigation process at the time. We did a couple things that were a bit unique, even by today's standards. And one of the first things we did was to remove the concept of blame from our process. One of the things we knew quite early on was that blame doesn't solve anything, and it's one of the key principles of human performance that
sure.
We'll talk about. But we knew we needed to understand what was behind these incidents, so we spent a lot of time. Our investigation process was very detailed. We'd spend 2 to 3, sometimes 4 or 5 weeks investigating a single incident. Now, these were fatalities most of the time, very serious injuries.
So you're also involved with investigating the incidents?
Yeah, absolutely.
Is that how you'd come up with your data and your research? So that was a big part of it, was part of the being part of the investigations?
Yeah, absolutely. So I became one of the investigators, mostly because my expertise is in the area of human systems, human performance. And so I became a team, an investigation leader way back in the early 1980s. And investigation was one of the primary areas where we started looking, gathering information, trying to understand incidents really thoroughly. What were the causal and contributing factors? And we learned that fundamentally the biggest issue is around system and process and the way we set people up for either success or failure through those systems and processes. A lot of things have changed over the years. We did manage to reduce our injury levels and fatalities to zero by 1983, first year in the history of Ontario Hydro.
By adjusting the processes?
By doing thorough investigations, by implementing some major changes to process, mostly around recognizing where the real hazards were. And why people found themselves in the situation they did, and then coming up with barriers and controls that would help to prevent those types of events from occurring. And a lot of it really, as you can imagine, was around personal protective equipment, fall protection, and the use of live line tools, which were evolving at the time, understanding things like reach envelopes, which is one of our areas of expertise. What we were doing as ergonomists was studying the linemen at work,
right?
In the situations that they had to operate
in their environment.
Yeah, and then we would look at things like, all right, so now you're up on a pole, you're working on an energized system, and you're working with live line tools. But do you realize where your body is in the context of that environment? And a lot of times people really didn't until we were able to demonstrate kind of some of those particular factors. It's one of the problems that occurred. People would get their heads or arms or whatever and not realize that they, although in front of them they were okay, in behind them they were now.
Sounds silly, but almost a self-awareness.
Absolutely.
Like spatial awareness.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. And once you show people, we were able to, model some concepts around space envelopes, for example, just so that people could see what is around me and where are things. And so what do I need to do to protect myself? And a lot of work was done to evolve some of the systems and processes that we now use commonly.
On the training side, so you'd put systems and processes in place.
Yeah.
What about like the behavioral side and how you train the linemen on the behavioral side to change their behavior so that, or did you deal with that at all?
Yeah, absolutely. Certainly from the things that we learned, we put together training and development programs to increase a level of knowledge and awareness.
Because just changing a system or just changing a process within a system, you just have to get them to buy into doing that to begin with.
Correct.
Yeah.
And as you know, nobody likes change.
Yeah.
So there was a lot of resistance initially.
Right.
You start to making people wear fall protection equipment when they're climbing a pole.
We definitely have that attitude in this trade. It's still there. It's changing. It is changing with the generations, I think. But that attitude, that old school mentality, this is the way we used to do it. So this is the way we're going to do it now. It's hard to beat out of us.
I think it's your point is well taken. And I think part of the problem, it isn't just about linemen in that particular instance. It's about people in general. The way I like to think about it is this. People are efficiency experts, right? Mm-hmm. We want to get things done. We go out to do a job.
Yeah.
And
especially in this trade, that one thing I've noticed within the trade, efficiency is no wasted moves. That's
absolutely. And we know that our business is centered around getting the job done. Mm-hmm. We're not out there to be safe. We're out there to do a job. We're hopefully safe while we're doing that job, but we're out there to do a job. And linemen are one of those trades where that factor is really important to the individuals. They have a sense of accomplishment as a result of like any construction industry. When you're building things, you're putting up tower lines or you're putting up, you know, distribution systems or underground systems, doesn't matter. Have a sense of accomplishment. You're there to, you know, expand the system or improve the system or repair the system.
And you can visually see what you create in the end.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Which is a lot different than, you know, working on computers and stuff like that, for the most part. You can visually see something constructed and something you've built, and you can drive by it every day for the rest of your life.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's instilled in the trade through the apprenticeship program, through the development program, that being expert at what you do, being the best at what you are, is really important within the trade, and accomplishing those tasks is really critical. You're here to get this stuff done, to do it right, but to get it done. And you can't stand there and tell anybody. I was no different on a farm. I mean,
yeah, you know, for sure.
My job was to, you know, to get the hay into the barn.
Yeah.
Well, then that's what I was going to do, and I did my best to make sure that got done and got done successfully. You know, it wasn't that I was, you know, I was reckless about it. It's just, that's the job. Yeah. That's what you're there to do.
Yeah.
So that's what people do.
Yeah.
Recognizing that, we also recognize that people make mistakes along the way.
Yeah. Right?
We make decisions, and there are a couple of interesting factors. Those decisions are usually correct. They're usually the right decisions. Everything turns out okay. As it turns out, you know, in the field of performance, we usually get it right. Because we usually get it right, we can and do make the assumption that, well, it worked that time, it should work the next time, and normally it does, until it doesn't.
Yeah.
Then we look back at it with hindsight, and this is one of the problems that occurred fairly early in investigation processes. We started looking at these incidents in hindsight and said, all events are preventable.
Right.
Well, they're all preventable in hindsight,
yeah,
but they're not necessarily all preventable in foresight. We plan, we do the best we can, we identify the hazards, but workplaces, and especially our workplaces in the line trade, are very dynamic.
Yeah, very complex too.
Yeah, and so when you look at some of the principles of human performance, going back to some of the stuff that, you know, that the specialists have come up with, things like procedural use and adherence, for example. Well, if you look at the line trade, there are very few actual procedures that we can develop that people can actually follow verbatim, right? Because every situation is a little bit different. So it is necessary for the lineman to adapt. And we expect that. We require that. So that adaptation usually, again, is successful. Every now and then,
right,
it's not. So the issue of performance improvement, the issue of error management, and the issue of incident management now comes down to, how do we make sure that we have a robust system that will allow us to do our jobs
and be dynamic?
Be dynamic, make those decisions, every now and then make a mistake and still be okay. Mm-hmm. And that's the theme of today's, you know, human performance kinds of initiatives that you'll find in industry.
Is that why human performance is becoming so prevalent today?
It's one of the reasons, yeah. You know, there's been a lot of study into what the causal and contributing factors around incidents are. And as I said before, for a period of time, we were just blaming the operators, whether it was a pilot,
right.
You know, we'd blame pilot error on an airline crash. And we, you know, with better investigation methodologies, with better models to work from, we've come to realize that it's not about human error per se. It's about whether or not our systems are robust enough to allow us to operate and operate effectively in these complex environments. And we do operate in increasingly complex environments. So there are issues of complexity, And, you know, some of the language around human performance improvement today is around things like building capacity within a system, building resilience within a system so that we can be who we are, take advantage of who we are. We're good decision makers. We are not robots. Robots are extremely good at doing the same thing over and over again with complete accuracy. We are not. We don't do very well in that environment. We do much better as in an adaptive environment. The other thing that's happened in the area of human performance and studying of human systems and in fields like biology, psychology, and evolutionary theory is to understand who we are from an evolutionary perspective. And we've come to realize that, you know, we as Homo sapiens sapiens evolved the way we did. We were successful as, or are successful as a species because of how we've evolved. And we evolved certain capabilities, and one might describe certain things as biases that have allowed us to be successful. And those biases insert themselves in our decision processes all the time.
Right.
So it's about why would I spend a lot of time thinking about something when I know based on the patterns that I see that there's a 90% chance that it's this.
Yeah.
Right? And so we go ahead under the assumption that this is correct. And most of the time we're right.
Yeah. We live in a state of following patterns for the most part. We probably, I don't know what the percentage would be, but it's probably a very small percentage of life outside of a pre-existing pattern.
Habitual behavior, absolutely. And again, that's, you know, part of it is built into that evolutionary system that we've evolved.
So is it recognizing that then?
Part of it, yeah, absolutely. It's realizing that there are certain things that we have a tendency to do. And we also, you know, if you think about skill development, for example, a simple example of driving a car. If you thought about putting a procedure together for driving a car, you'd realize very quickly that it's impossible. Yeah. You could write the procedure, but no one could follow it because they would crash or wouldn't be able to get the vehicle even going if they tried to follow the procedure. Because the behaviors are skills that we develop, and they become habitual, automatic. We get into a vehicle, and we know what to do, and we do it automatically, and we do it really well, and we're highly skilled at it. There's no way that our highway systems and the complex urban environments we operate in would be successful if we couldn't do that.
Yeah.
We would never get anywhere.
I often think about like another species from another planet coming to ours for the first time and seeing cars, these objects hurling towards each other, separated by 2 feet.
So it's those are some of the advantages that we have, the skills and abilities that we have, our creativity, our opposable thumbs, our large brains allow us to evolve an environment and modify our environments too, so that we can live pretty much anywhere, even in places where, you know, by nature we couldn't possibly survive. So those are all advantages that we have. But every now and then they become disadvantages because of the situation or circumstance we find ourselves in. But here's another interesting thought. So one of the things that's happened over the last few years is in part of this new movement within safety, particularly, the question has been asked, what's the difference between successful behavior and unsuccessful behavior? Unsuccessful being we didn't accomplish what we had set out to accomplish. We had an incident or whatever. And the answer is just the outcome. That's it. We do the same things. We make the same decisions based on the same criteria, mm-hmm. whether we are successful or unsuccessful. It's just the outcome. So what that leads us to understand is that it's the circumstances that we find ourselves in and the situations. We do the best we can to make the right decisions. And, you know, we all know that sometimes people just do things they know they shouldn't do. Get themselves into hot water and then you know, we can deal with that. And that's a little bit of a different issue. But the vast majority of time, in all the investigations I've done, and I've done many, here's what I've found. Except in very rare instances, people go to work in the morning with the intent of doing their job. They don't wake up in the morning thinking about how they're going to mess up that day, right?
Yeah.
They think more about what have I got to do today and what am I going to do when I get home, because I got, you know, I got my windows to paint, and you know, I got my kids are in soccer, and you know those are the things that we think about.
Yeah.
We don't think about making mistakes. We don't think about messing up. We just think about going to work, and so as a consequence of that, knowing that, there's nothing deliberate about people making mistakes. It's just part of the environment we operate in, part of the challenges that each one of us has when we start out at the beginning of every day. So what that helps us understand is we need to look for those factors that are contributing to that breakdown of process, that negative result, that are part of the world that the individual has to operate in. What are those things? And then what are the things that we can do to help address those issues in a functional and effective way? And here's what we've learned. The system is a system, and we can work on the system. We can try to improve the system, and we do. Right? So we can work on that aspect. We can make the system better. We can have better tools. We can have better processes. We can modify our environments. We can provide opportunity for better decisions. But then we also have what we call barriers and controls that we put in place to help build some redundancy, some defense in depth, if you will.
Sure.
So if something does happen, it's like, you know, the James Reason right. Swiss cheese model, right?
Right.
All the things have to line up the wrong way in order for an event to occur.
So an example of that would be like a limits of approach rule with built-in redundancy.
Yeah, so it's the combination of the training and skill the individual has, mm-hmm. the personal protective equipment that they have, the tools, the specialized tools that we have, you know, the rules around limits of approach, our bonding and grounding principles, they're all part of that defense in depth system. And one of the reasons why, when I look at Altec and the way we tend to do our work, especially in energized systems, we're very successful at it because we use all of those barriers, all of those defenses. And that's fundamental to the whole process. And, there are some things that we have envisioned or imagined that don't work so well. Some of the event-free tools, for example, around things like stop, and check. And, the problem with stopping is that most people can't.
Right.
Or don't.
Yeah.
Because that's not the objective.
Yeah.
Right? The objective isn't to stop. Tell people to stop is actually a very difficult thing. And the stop work concept has evolved in both the regulatory environment and in industry as a key principle.
Yeah.
It's like we have the right to stop on safe work, for example.
We as humans like to be in a state of flow, especially in the trade, in line work. It's all about flow.
Absolutely, and along with that, when you're in a process, you've usually evolved that process based on what you believe is going to be a successful outcome.
Sure.
So you're not looking at it and saying, I see a big problem there, and so I got to stop.
Yeah.
Unless something emerges, unless something radical changes. You're not even aware. You're just proceeding as you normally do, because we all operate within hazardous environments. It's all these other things around us that help us to control those. And so we know we have energized systems, right?
Yeah.
When we're working on an energized system. So we're not going to stop and say, I got an energized system, because we already know. Yeah. And we've put controls and processes in place. So so the problem with stop work is that it's not very effective as a concept. What's better and what's coming, what's emerging now is, let's do everything we can to make sure that we are ready to work, that we have all the systems and processes in place, so that we have a robust control and barrier system there. We have defense in depth. We have resilience, if you will.
Sure.
So that we will be successful. And even if we make the odd error, it's not going to have any significant consequence. So that's the emphasis now.
So you're trying to pre-predict things that you may have in the past had to or needed to stop for and look at, is that and make sure that you're prepared ahead of time so you don't have to stop.
Correct. That's actually a good succinct way to put it. How we do that is by looking at, things like the work that's occurred, and in fact, these days, by going out and looking at work as it occurs. So one of the principles that has evolved fairly recently is the concept of work as imagined versus work as done. Okay. So when we look at work as imagined, that's our job plan. That's, you know, we do our tail boards. More complex work, we'll have a job plan. We might have a work order. We might have a project plan.
A few procedures attached to that.
Correct. Yeah. It's a bunch of stuff that kind of gets tagged on to that plan. So that's the way we think it's going to go. But everybody who's done work realizes that a job plan is just a job plan, and everything evolves as the day progresses. Mm-hmm. And especially in the line trade, especially in the construction line trade, the work constantly evolves. So the plan is there. It's a good reference point. What we're trying to do with those plans is add a new element. And this is something that hasn't been done for a while. We used to do it. And as an ergonomist, I told you back when I first started as an ergonomist, this is what I actually did. Was I went out and spent time with the line crews and went around with them, worked with them through the days and learned what they did, how they did it, why they did it that way. And we made a lot of modifications and adjustments to process through that. That kind of got lost along the way. We operated under the assumption that we knew it all, I think, at one point, and said, yeah, okay, we've got hazard identification processes. We've got all these barriers and controls. We put them all in place, and everything should go honky-dory, right? It's not how it works.
What I see is a lack of resources, like people like yourself being able to keep up with the change and being able to see the industry evolve so fast and is growing so fast. How do you keep up with that by getting people like yourself out there to see and monitor and make these changes? Like, that's what I kind of see is we end up falling into like a compliance or you get safety professionals out on site that aren't as skilled as you or can't pinpoint some of these things and make these changes. You know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. That's a good key point as well. So one of the challenges we have in this industry, especially around human performance, is just exactly what you said. We have clients out there who have evolved systems around certain key principles. So one of those key principles is the assumption that all incidents are follow the Newtonian rule, right?
Right.
Of cause and effect relationships. Like Newton's third law, for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. And again, the world just doesn't operate that way when it comes to human performance and human behavior. because our systems and processes are built under that model, it's one of the reasons why it tends to fail at times. Because it isn't the way people operate. We are synthesizers of information. Our decisions are based on everything from our evolutionary foundation and mm-hmm. the habit patterns and biases that have evolved to make us successful, to the specific input that we get with respect to a situation, and all the factors that are influencing us in terms of our state of mind, etc., at that particular point in time. So it's complicated. Yeah. It isn't simple, and it isn't linear, right?
Yeah.
So the problem with linear modeling is that it really doesn't anticipate a lot of the situations that we have to deal with.
I found a line worker like a child. That's why in the apprenticeship process or in the apprenticeship stage or the first stages of becoming a construction line worker or a line worker, it's how important that is to be passing down or teaching correct principles and correct procedures and correct way of doing things or to the best of your ability. Because I found that people right in that stage, what they learn in that stage is taken with them for sometimes an entire career. Like a child learning something in early stages of life, those patterns are taken with that child sometimes for their entire life. Same thing in the line trade. I noticed a lot of things, and a lot of people carry with them things they learned in their apprenticeship as fact, non-changeable programming for their entire careers. And I think it takes generations to work that out. And that's kind of where we're getting from that old school mentality to now that things are finally starting to work. Some of those things are finally starting to work their way out. And I don't know. I think it needs to be addressed.
Yes, agreed. And yet another good point. Part of the challenge there is development in the line trade is through the apprenticeship program, which means that if you want an operational standard or a set of principles or a value system to be a part of the trade, it has to be imparted by the leaders,
mm-hmm.
the people who are teaching those apprentices. And that's a big challenge. We have people from my generation who grew up a particular way.
For sure.
And that's what
I'm saying. Like, that's how important that is to nail it down at that stage, and how important it is every day to be making those changes and to be imparting good, solid advice and skill sets right at the beginning of someone's, because that's how you're going to change the trade.
Absolutely. And there's two parts to it, right? More than two, but at least two really critical parts.
Sure.
The first one is, what are we teaching the apprentices, right?
Mm-hmm.
And what are the teachers learning? What are we teaching the teachers? And it's one of the things that, you know, especially in a trade, someone might come to me as a senior individual and say, well, Jim, you've been there before. You've done this stuff. You know how to do it. And my chest will puff up and I'll feel good about myself and say, yeah, I do. And here's how you do it. But maybe I'm not right.
Right.
Maybe I've got an old idea. My ideas are no longer valid in today's environment because things have changed. You know, and we get back to the issue of efficiency. One of my favorite books by a guy named Eric Holnagel is The Efficiency There on a Trade-Off. And I always refer back to that as one of the key areas of understanding. Old school linemen were very efficient.
Yeah.
Just as new school linemen are very efficient. How they're efficient, the mechanisms by which we do things have changed and evolved. It's no longer acceptable to climb a pole without fall protection gear. But that's how I learned. That's how the people of my generation learned. The people of this generation don't learn that. They're not taught how to pole, to free climb a pole or a tower or anything else. They're taught how to use fall protection gear and equipment, etc. However, as you know, there are still some people around who
for sure
don't wear a seatbelt.
Yeah.
Don't wear the fall protection equipment. You know, I've worked in a number of companies and since I retired from Ontario Power Generation, and I got to tell you, I've been surprised by some of the stuff that I've seen, by the fact that people simply refuse to wear their fall protection gear in certain circumstances, and it just it's what, you know, what we're talking about. It's that habit pattern. It's their belief system. It's their value system that evolved way back when they didn't have to do that.
I think there's a touch of, like, there's honestly a touch of laziness there as well. They're, 'cause humans, like, part of creating efficiencies is also just being lazy, because it's easier to just not belt or not clip to that piece of lacing, to take two more steps before you clip your hook into the next piece of lacing, because I can reach it and I can easily make that move.
Well, I'm glad you used the term lazy. And the reason is because here's the way I want you to think about human behavior going forward. So we're going to talk about how do we change a value system or an attitude. We're not lazy.
Okay.
We don't like to waste time and energy doing things that we know we can do without having to waste time and energy. And it goes back to, hey, I've done this 1,000 times. It works just fine. Sure. I don't need to use that. And you know, you spoke to the issue of compliance a while back. This is one of the challenges that we have in our environment today. We've become very rigid in compliance-based methodology, and it's really causing some serious problems. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't be compliant to certain things. I'm not saying don't wear your fall protection equipment.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. You have to wear your fall protection equipment. It's really good equipment. It's well designed. It will save your life. But with an overemphasis on compliance, we're not allowing for human variability and human decision processes and the things that make us unique. Our ability to adapt, our understanding that, yes, there is a better way. There is a more efficient way to do things. Yes, this is getting in the way. Sometimes we need to change those behaviors because we know, yes, it may be more efficient, you know, to climb a tower, a pole, or whatever, without fall protection equipment. You're going to get up there faster, and you're going to get down faster. What we also know, though, is when things go wrong, they go badly wrong, and we can't afford that. So we've put some systems in place that are causing us to be less efficient, if you will. However, we're safer. Mm-hmm. So we have fewer fatalities. I can tell you without hesitation that, you know, in our effort to reduce fatalities in Ontario Hydro, the things that were of greatest significance, aside from attitude change, and that was big, mm-hmm. Was the use of better tools and equipment, better fall protection gear, better live line tools, better processes to make sure that we were controlling those hazards. So that stuff's real.
Yeah.
And it is important. But we're not lazy. We're efficient.
Yeah.
And
you're right, we are.
You know, we're not gonna walk a 90-degree angle on a sidewalk when we can cut the corner.
Yeah,
it's what we do.
It's how we got here.
Yeah. And when you think about it, it makes perfect sense. Like, so we design systems that are not consistent with who we are.
Right.
We're creating these problems. Most people just ignore the issue and they'll cut across the corner. And most of the time, that's perfectly fine and perfectly safe until something changes and then something goes wrong. And then we say, well, you know, had they followed the designated path, they would have been fine. Well, that's true. But maybe we should have created a different path.
Yeah.
And made that path safe. The one that people want to follow as opposed to the one we force them into following. And one of the things that I know as an ergonomist, and one of the key principles that I learned a long time ago, is that the field of engineering is a fantastic and amazing field, and as a result of engineering improvements that have occurred in the world, we have so many things that we wouldn't have had. But one of the issues with engineering is typically we engineer things for functionality, for purpose. We build things the way we do because it's easier to build it that way in some cases. And then afterwards, we think about, well, where's the person going to fit?
Right.
right? Yep. We have so many examples. Where this all started, at least part of it, is, you know, with the advent of the industrial era, and especially with the technological changes that occurred through between the First and Second World Wars, one of the areas where human factors and ergonomics got involved really early was in the military industry. Mm-hmm. And in cockpit design, one of the things that was discovered was, pilots were crashing their planes just in practice. We were losing a lot of pilots. Well, you're in war, you need your pilots, right?
Yeah.
You don't want to lose them unless you lose them in battle. You don't want to lose them there either. But if you're going to lose them, that's where you want to lose them, not trying to get the plane off the ground. Right. And what happened was they were cranking out aircraft so quickly that they didn't have standard configurations for operational controls. So a plane, every time a pilot got into a plane, he had to relearn what these new set of controls were going to do.
Right.
So no standardization. So one time he'd pull back on a lever and the plane would go up, and the next time he'd pull back on the lever and the plane would go down. And those are not good differences, right?
No, so, not when you got to make the adjustments on the fly or not.
Literally, yeah, exactly. So a lot of work went into understanding the concept of consistency and standardization of design for operational purposes. And you can look at almost any piece of work. Look at motor vehicle cars, for example. When we started to, when different countries started developing automotive industries, one of the things that happened fairly early was the cars were being designed for local populations and based on whatever standard they might have set in that particular place.
Right.
But now we started to develop this global market where now we're shipping cars all over the world from Europe and Asia and North America to all other parts of the world. So now you have a car made in Germany or Britain where all the controls are on the opposite side of the vehicle. And, the signal light might be on the right-hand side and windshield washers on the left, whereas our vehicle's here, it might be the opposite. And so people are trying to turn on the windshield wipers and they're,
Or shifting gears, one with the left hand and one with the right hand.
Yeah, there's all kinds of cool stuff like that. So there's been a recognition, and you'll find that in the field of ergonomics particularly, a lot of the contributors from ergonomics and human factors are those types of things where we realize, the more we can, create predictability, and it can be everything as simple as the chair beside me here, which has a set of operational controls, and they're standardized now. Mm-hmm. So, they all do the same thing. So once you learn how to adjust this chair, you can adjust almost all other chairs.
Right.
Because the controls do the same thing on all the chairs. And those are important things to understand. So again,
that's going to take mass organization though, because that takes utilities talking to each other, communicating on the same level, making adjustments on their systems so that things are the same.
Absolutely. And there's all kinds of barriers to those types of changes. Mm-hmm. Most of them are economic.
Right. Not just changes to their system, but changes to the way they operate on their system and think about that and train for it.
Absolutely. And again,
it's like a global standard.
In the last 30 years, engineers are now being taught about human factors and ergonomics, and they're starting to design things differently. They're looking at not just, will this gadget work, but can I get the gadget where I need it to go? I remember a really good example. We had this very complex piece of equipment that we're using to examine the internal aspects of a nuclear calandria. And this device was like 75 feet long and weighed a couple tons. And so it's not a little thing. It's a really big piece of equipment. Highly sensitive, very sophisticated piece of equipment. And I was involved with the design team, and I listened to them. It sounded really good. And I, at one point I said, okay, so I have two questions. Right, you've got this thing all rigged up and you want to be able to see part of the control systems within the calandria, which is the big tank that all the fuel rods fit into.
Yeah.
And it had a camera in it. And they wanted to be able to see where this one component fit within this, the structural wall of the Calandria. So they put the camera in there. So you've got fittings on both the east and west walls, right? But your camera, does it swivel? And they said, oh, yeah. You know, I said, okay, good. So now we got to make sure that it swivels. I said, the second thing is, how are you going to get it in there? Like, how are you going to insert this tool? It's 75 feet long and it weighs several tons. Well, we'll pick it up with a crane and we'll dump it in. I said, and where are you going to attach it to this sensitive tool? You have no attachment points. Simple things.
Yeah, yeah.
But their minds and their brains, brilliant. These are brilliant people. Yeah. Are focused on making a gadget that will do stuff, right?
Designed a way to get to the moon, but couldn't figure out how to put a camera on it.
So there's a lot of work that's been done, and you look at some of the work in both, you know, the utility industry, the space industry, etc. There have been a lot of improvements, and it gets better all the time. But it's an evolving process.
This is part of the evolutionary process.
Absolutely. On an advanced scale.
Yeah.
An advanced time scale. I think, you know, we've covered a lot of good ground. I think there's, you know, some of the stuff that I would like to leave as sort of a, so what do we do about all this? Like, how do we make the world a better place? How do we make
how
it
do
safer?
We as linemen,
right? How do we make
for the most part? It's the linemen and the line workers in the industry listening to this for now.
Correct. And so what do we do for linemen to make their world safer and better, and consistent with the principles of human performance? And I think one of the things we're starting to do is go back out and take a look at, so what's it like out here? People like me, yep. We've got to get out into the field and spend time with our guys. And, you know, in the safety organization, it's something that we do, you know, and it's a fundamental part of how we operate. So
what's some advice from you, someone who's done this for years, to people just getting into this, like these safety professionals or line workers for that matter too, to go out there and look at a job site, look at the way we work, and not just focus on whether the guy's wearing his safety glasses or his buck squeeze is done up or...
Right. I've got several comments around that. For those of you listening out there, take this with a grain of salt. Not all safety people are created equal. So there are safety people who have some good fundamental training and understanding compliance-based issues. So naturally, they're going to focus on compliance. If that's their emphasis, if that's their training and that's their background and that's the emphasis that they've been taught, that's what they're going to tend to do. There are other safety professionals out there who have a much broader base background. So I think to some degree, part of the issue is, who are we selecting as our safety, for our safety organization, for people to go out? We have to pick people who are going to be able to understand what they're looking at, who are willing and capable of working with linemen out in the field, understand how linemen work, understand the actual mechanisms and processes and tools and equipment that linemen have to work with, and then understand some of the principles that I've learned over the years, particularly as an ergonomist, in terms of how can we make some of those things better. So we need to go out, we need to spend more time in the field and understand a lineman's world from a lineman's perspective, and understand why they're doing the things that they're doing and making the decisions that they're making, because they make sense.
Right.
But we have to understand how they make sense and what things might have to change in order for us to reduce the potential for.
It needs to be done as well, open-mindedly from both parties. And I think just speaking from the Lions side, you know, like when the safety guy, quotations, shows up on site, it's usually like, oh, God, tighten up, like get your shit straight. This guy's going to call us out on everything. He's going to shut our job down or whatever. But we have to get past that the person here watching us work and talking, interacting with us is here to help, not just crucify.
Right. And, you know, I got to ask.
That's a big part of it.
I have to ask you a question because I am a little puzzled. I've never been in a position where I've gone out and shut a job down or rag somebody out on a job site. Does that happen?
Yeah, it does. It does. It really does. Are they they get into the little things, those little compliance things, and they hone in on those. It's because it's all they know, like you just said. Like, okay. It's all they know. Like, hey, you don't have your chaps, but I'm in a bucket. Why do I need chaps? I'm reaching out of a bucket. I have a three-inch thick fiberglass bucket around me as chaps, not, you know. It's stuff like that.
Yeah, fair enough. What has to happen, obviously, is, one, we need to develop our safety professionals and safety people sufficiently so that they are not just compliance-based. And that's something that we're trying to work on here. We've got some new processes that are coming, that are evolving right now, where in something called learning teams, for example, I'm going to be taking all of our health and safety people through a workshop on how to run a learning team, how to do an investigation properly, and remove the blame concepts and start to work with our linemen in terms of understanding their world better so that we can give better advice and be better support. You're right. Part of the problem that has evolved in the safety world is that we have a whole bunch of compliance-based people out there. And part of the reason that evolved is because at some point, it seems like the industry has decided that we have all the answers.
Another one, sorry to interrupt again, though, but like take it a step further, and I think this is probably the more important one, is when we talked about cutting that corner before,
right.
Maybe it's that corner, it's cutting that corner that guys don't want safety people to see, because those corners get cut every day and it's what's got us to this point. And that corner may be a violation of the limits of approach in order to do a task, but it's like it's a calculated risk in their mind. For the most part, it is. They'll mm-hmm. not necessarily stop work, but they'll talk about it as a bucket team or something, two people in a bucket going to do a task, so reach up and put a cotter key in, or, you know, but they're violating limits of approach to do a certain task. But a safety professional may just see that as straight up violation, limits of approach, you're done kind of a thing, when it was, you know.
Absolutely. So the principle behind spending more time with the trade in a mutually safe environment, so that it's going to take some effort to build that confidence and build the trust in order to be able to do these things. I mean, when I worked with Ontario Hydro and I did investigations, clearly when we first started, people were terrified of investigators.
Sure.
And said, oh, you're coming out here to fire me or whatever. And we didn't do that. It took us probably a year or two in the process just to gain the trust of the people.
Build a relationship.
Recognizing that our objective was to learn, was to improve, was to create a better environment, not to punish people.
I like that.
And we need to do the same thing here. We need to help people understand. I'm going to go up to Prince George soon. And my purpose is to go up and work with the guys, meet with the guys, talk to the guys, and understand some of the things that are going on in their environment that they need some help with, and then help them. And in that process, I'm going to have to develop that trust relationship. They're going to have to, yeah. I'm going to have to demonstrate to them that, you know, I mean what I say, that there's no blame in this process. It's about learning, and we've got to get there. We've got to get blame out of the process. We've got to get trust relationships built. Yep. We've got to get our safety people more aligned with what our line trade is doing. We've got to have those conversations where the lineman can feel comfortable sitting down with me, for example, and saying, we've got a situation here where we're going to have to violate the limits of approach. Here's how we want to do that. And I have to be able to say, well, that's okay, as long as. Yep. Right? So we go back to that those principles of resilience and say, okay, there are certain circumstances where we're going to have to, you know, move beyond the rule and to allow us to accomplish the task effectively. And as long as we have the defense in depth that we've defined and that we adhere to it, that we're okay. Right. Because at the end of the day, limits of approach is one barrier. It's not all of the barriers.
Sure.
Right? It's not all of the controls. And you're right. You know, strict compliance is extremely difficult in the line trade. Mm-hmm. When I worked in the nuclear world, they spent a lot of time on that. Verbatim compliance.
Sure.
Processes, strict compliance to rules, verification and verifying what the verifiers verified was a process and a protocol that they developed.
It's really how the world has set up the last century, right? It started with the industrial age of building factory workers, and just even look at the way our education system is built to train factory workers, and it's still today, it's still the same today. Go to school, memorize something for the rest of your life that's not going to apply to the rest of your life, and build factory workers. But line work's not a factory. It's very, very dynamic, very complex, and changes every day.
Yes. So within the apprenticeship program, that's the tricky part of developing the skill set, knowledge, skills, and capabilities of a power line technician. And it's a very dynamic process in and of itself. And it also, as we had discussed earlier, has to evolve, because some of the stuff that we used to do, we just can't do anymore. It's not acceptable. I think if I'm correct, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, I think what line apprentices are learning these days is a lot more stuff, a lot more sophisticated process, a lot more sophisticated equipment and tools, a lot more sophisticated communication systems and processes than what a lineman from 30 years ago learned.
Yeah. In some areas.
Yeah. But and I know this very well, in other areas, it hasn't changed at all. Yeah. We're still slogging and hauling and lifting and twisting and doing a lot of the things we've always done. Mm-hmm. But we can change those things.
Yep.
It takes time. It's not going to happen overnight. But I've seen a lot of really good change over the years. And I know that we have a lot fewer fatalities now than what we used to have.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot fewer serious injuries than what we used to have. Because we do have better stuff. We do have better knowledge and the attitudes are better. I find even with my kids, the educational system that they went through caused them to have a different attitude. They won't accept things that I just accepted.
Yeah.
Because the boss said, go do this. And
yeah. Well, we have Google now.
that's part of it. You're, absolutely.
Google it.
So you have...
Well, you're lying.
That's right. You have more information at your fingertips. Yeah. You have access to information that, you know, people from 30 years ago simply didn't have. But it's also, you know, the understanding that you have the freedom and liberty to go and research that information, to look up those issues, to ask the questions, and to not just accept things because the boss said, go do it. there is a better questioning attitude, if you will, among the younger generations. And that's something, again, that we have to teach our leaders about. So, you know, one of the things that I also wanted to say about, so how do we make things better? Mm-hmm. Well, we need to teach our leaders, the people who are teaching us.
Agreed.
About some of these key principles and concepts as well, so that they, and we have to select, I'm going to say, those people who get it,
yeah.
Who buy into the new
or open-minded enough are open-minded to change over time.
Correct.
Or willing to learn.
Exactly, and recognize that some of the things that they did in the past are simply not acceptable anymore. And we
even if they don't necessarily know it now, or they're willing to change, willing to learn these things and then start to apply them rather than having that rigid mindset.
Yes. One of the complicators in all this is, and we've been discussing it throughout, is the fact that we are a very compliance-based system in a lot of areas these days, especially with our client groups. And that creates a level of conflict and frustration, in all of us at times. And those are challenges that we have to continually deal with. There's some stuff that we just got to do because we got to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And as long as it's not putting us in harm's way, well, then we have to do it until we can evolve a new system. We in the safety field, who are on the leading edge of what's going on out there, understand that in the safety world, we've evolved a bunch of processes that are not only not useful, but in fact can be the opposite. They can create problems, and we have to tease those out of the system. Right? We have to get rid of some of that stuff. Some of the non-useful filling out of paper, for example, a lot of the stuff that happens out there is, we got supervisors and managers spending a lot of time filling out forms to prove to the client that, we are in compliance with their requirements when it really doesn't do anything. It's just a piece of paper. What really matters is how people operate. And the interesting thing is that I've seen some real conflicts between what the client asks for and what they even expect us to do. Because especially with the line trade, one of the things that our clients value tremendously is our adaptability,
mm-hmm.
our ability to get the job done regardless of conditions, weather, environment, terrain.
They need it.
Yeah, and so they value it. And then, on the other hand, might turn around and say, you're not in compliance with this particular rule, and then you have sort of an impossible situation. So I think teasing out some of those issues is part of
it's an understanding that this is going to be a lifetime for everybody of change. So it's really just, it's really a mindset change. And everybody needs to change their mindset. If you change your mindset, we can carry that.
Yeah, I think it's values and it's principles that we need to focus in around. And, becoming a learning organization, removing blame from process so that you can be a learning organization is key to that. It changes everything. It really does.
Yeah.
Until, and from my experience, what I've seen, I've asked myself many times, what did we do 35 years ago that allowed us to go from 5 or 6 fatalities a year to 0 and stay there? Because we did.
Yeah.
And the answer is, we stopped blaming people and we started learning.
Good.
And it made all the difference because it opened up people's minds. It gave people confidence. It built trust. And so then when we came along with a new tool or a new process, people were willing to try it.
Yeah.
Now, they weren't just shoving it off and saying, oh, I don't want to take that thing, get out of here. They were trying it. They were working with it. Same thing now, There are better ways of doing things, and it has to be a back-and-forth discussion. Mm. The safety world can't dictate process. I think the best that we can do is we can look at those value systems. It's like, what is successful? And you know, what makes a company successful from a safety point of view? Is it that they have a managed system? Is it that they have a binder with a bunch of stuff in it? Or is it the way we do things, right? The value systems that we have, the ability to make the right decisions, to have the trust in the organization to know that when you make that decision, you'll be supported. Is it more that we have the ability to learn from one another, as opposed to blind compliance to a rule? I've worked with managed systems for many years, and I believe strongly that we do need managed processes, especially in complex environments, in order to be able to operate effectively, efficiently. On the other hand, we can't allow those managed system processes to stifle us and to not allow creativity and the ability to adapt to 100%. Circumstances. It has to support those things. So that's what we have to work on marrying in the human performance world, is how do we get our systems to support what we have to do out in the field, as opposed to try to drive what we do out in the field.
Right.
Because we can plan all we like.
Yeah.
But work will happen the way it happens because of the circumstances that people find themselves in, the knowledge and skills they have to be able to do the job effectively. And here's the one thing that I would say that we probably gained most from the James Reason world of human performance and human error. And that is the recognition that there are different performance modes that the individual's in every day. And
right.
There are sort of three fundamentally defined performance modes in the operational model. Skill-based performance, where a person is fully competent, fully skilled, and really knows how to do the job and does it correctly pretty much all the time. And we know that the error rates for those that performance mode are very low. Rule-based mode is where we are not exposed to a situation very often. We find ourselves being somewhat aware and, you know, having to go and look up, you know, what it is that we did the last time and, you know, follow some fundamental rules around how we want to be able to accomplish that task this time around. And the error rate for that mode is higher. And then finally, knowledge-based mode, where people are completely unfamiliar, have never seen this before, and they have to kind of just make it up as they go. And the error rates there are very high.
Right.
So I think one of the things that we can do as we progress forward and and understand work as it's done is to realize what mode people are operating in at any given point in time. You know, when we're sitting down there making our plans, are we operating from a skill base?
Right.
Have we done this before? Is this something that we know really, really well? Or is it something that we've only ever done a few times, and so we're going to have to really put more thought and time into planning it and understanding, you know, how to go about doing this thing? Or is this something we've never even seen before, and so now we're going to really need some help in trying to figure out the best way to go about this? And it's a trial and error thing, and so we know the error potential is going to be higher.
Yeah.
One of the challenges we have in our environment is that, and we talked about it throughout, is we have a highly changing environment to which we must constantly adapt. And it's building those adaptive skills that Sure. is fundamental to the line trade. And so, you know, recognizing those performance modes, working on building the skills, not just in the line workers themselves, but in their supervisors and mm-hmm. in their leaders and the 100%. People doing the planning. So that they have support in the decision processes. And when they find themselves in a circumstance that they realize is not what they should be working with. And this is one of the things that I'm struggling with now with the line trade is, regardless of what we find when we get there, we deal with it.
Right.
And sometimes we shouldn't.
Right.
Sometimes we should back away and say, this is unacceptable. We can't work in these conditions. Somebody come and help us here. We're not good at that. We need to get better at that.
That's definitely going to take a change on everybody's part.
Absolutely. It has to.
Because that does not follow the productivity model.
No, it doesn't. That's absolutely true. Yeah. From a superficial point of view, but if you think about productivity, the thing that we're going to have to start doing is think about it in terms of not just how much money do we make when we get the job done, it's how much do we lose when we get it wrong.
Yeah.
And so one of the things I've always done is, both as an ergonomist and as a safety professional, is do a cost benefit on anything that I propose. As an ergonomist, I propose some changes. I would prepare a cost benefit model and present the executive with options, mm-hmm. and say, well, here are the options, and here's your payback, and here's, you know, over the short term, the long term, right. what this is going to do for you. What we do know is that when we get it wrong, when we have an incident, it costs us a great deal of money.
Yeah.
And we can lose all of our profit with a single event. And in fact, in our trade, in the line trade, you can lose the business in a single event.
Yeah.
And that's something that I think most people are aware of, is that it is critical, but not everybody's aware of that. And, you know, understanding that every now and then we do have to push back, that it may appear as though it's costing us, and it does cost us time, but in the end, we will have saved a lot.
That's where I think you're going to get a lot of value in training your leaders and your leadership, so that your leaders are strong enough as well to make the decision to call that. Like, I think you get a lot of leadership saying, oh, just do it, you know,
yep.
because they're scared or not willing to make the call, the opposite call, because it's going to cost money.
Yep.
It's going to hit their budget. It's going to hit their.
Well, and that's a good point. I mean, you know, especially with our clients, they are the owners. They have the money, and they have the control. but we've had some interesting experiences over the years around those types of issues. And, you know, I know that there is a change that has to occur with the client as well. We had an issue a while back where we had an incident. And I investigated the incident. And basically one of the findings I had was that our client was telling us to do something in violation of their own process.
Right.
So when I presented it to the team, the immediate reaction was, oh, wow, you know, like, we're just going to have to eat this. I mean, we can't go back to the client and tell them that.
Yeah.
they're telling us to violate their own process. I mean, they'll just kick us off the job site. And I said, no. I said, we have to tell them. We have to work with them so that we can be successful. Otherwise, we're going to fail. Right. Yeah. We'll absolutely fail. And, you know, in that particular case, it was a regulatory issue as well. So we had a regulator involved, and now we're in trouble with the regulator as well as with the client. And I said, like, we can't operate this way. The client says that you must operate under certain conditions. Then we have to make sure that we have those conditions. They're responsible for providing those conditions. We have to make them provide those conditions, because otherwise we're going to be in violation, and then we're in trouble with them and with the regulator. So we have to have the confidence to push back and say, no, you know what? This is not the way to do that.
Absolutely.
And we did do that in that instance, and it worked out just fine.
That's a big way to evolve properly. We have to do that. In order to evolve properly.
Yes. And in order to get there, we have to make sure that we, in our safety professionals and our investigators, that they have the skills to identify those issues, mm-hmm. bring those to the table, and make sure that we are supported properly for, doing the things that we need to do. It's a So it's, you know, it's everybody is involved in the change process. Everybody's involved in this evolution of how we go about doing things and moving ourselves forward from, you know, the simple compliance world, so that, you know, which often becomes just a paper chase, to let's make sure that whatever we're doing works, that, you know, and that if it is not right, we got to be able to work together as a team to push back on the issues and make it right.
Yeah, 100%. Well, Jim, this is probably a good place to wrap it up. Is there anything else you'd like to address?
No, I think we've covered a lot of ground. I think if I wanted to summarize where I think the whole issue of human performance is, we've talked about it and we've touched on it, and I would just reiterate that we've got to work as a team in changing the attitudes, the expectations, and move from that blame environment to a learning environment. And if we can do that, if we can just do that, we'll have moved a long way forward.
For sure.
It is not common. It's not easy for us. I mean, one last little thought on this. Mm-hmm. Years ago, there was a guy named Aubrey Daniels who was a organizational psychologist, I believe he was, or is. And what Aubrey was trying to teach, and he wrote a couple of different books. One of them was called R+, and it was all about positive reinforcement. And this kind of aligns with some of the things we've been talking about. One of the things we're really, really bad at is positive reinforcement.
Yeah.
Yeah. We just don't do it very well.
Yeah. It's easier to blame. Easier to, yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. And, you know, we've been saying for decades now that positive reinforcement is a more powerful predictor of behavior, right? Of repeat behavior. So if you reinforce the positive behaviors that you're seeing, you're more likely to see those again. That's the theory.
I would like to add as well, the acceptance of the positive reinforcement. It's all in our nature to go, you know, but accept that. It's in our nature to go, no, thank you. But, you know, we should be accepting it. No, thank you. Thank you for that. No, I appreciate it.
You're absolutely right. It's not just a one-sided thing. It's both sides. Yeah. Because we're not used to being complimented. We're not used to being positively reinforced. We don't know how to receive it.
Yeah.
So you're right. We need to teach each other how to give positive reinforcement and how to receive positive reinforcement. And I've experienced that in my own life as well. It took a long time to...
I think the line trade is riddled with negative reinforcement.
Or punishment is a standard kind of protocol, right?
Yelling, that old school, you're worthless, data. But
And we've got to change those things.
Yeah.
It's not the way to do it.
Couldn't agree more.
So, you know, those types of fundamental concepts, they're catching hold. It's a slow process. I've been working at this for more than 35 years now, and you know, once an organization gets it, they get it, and they see the benefits of it. But it takes time, and it takes effort and it takes building that trust relationship again to be able to say, you know, I'm going to trust that when you say, if I follow this process, I do it right, that I'm going to get that positive reinforcement, and you're going to then give me that positive reinforcement. We don't do a very good job of performance management in that regard. We just, you know, we don't tell people how they're doing. You know, ultimately, if we do reward people, it's, you know, we watch the individuals, and especially, you know, and you know this yourself in the line trade, we'll watch a person. And we'll say, that guy's pretty good. He's really sharp. He's a go-getter. He gets it done, and he does it right. We're going to promote him. Right? and then we make him a sub foreman, and then we make him a foreman, and we take him through leadership processes. But do we teach him how to be a leader?
Yeah.
No, not normally. Some, you know, but it's more like the sit by Nelly approach. Like, watch what that foreman did, and that's kind of what foremen do.
Yeah.
And instead of taking them through an actual development program, saying, "Okay, I've got a guy here who is demonstrating real leadership ability. Let's bring him along. Let's take him through some development and training on the leadership side. Let's find out if he actually wants to be a leader."
Yeah.
Right? And wants to take on that role. A lot of guys don't.
No.
You know, they're put in the position and they don't really want to be there, and so they're kind of standing back and kind of hoping that things go okay.
Yeah. Well, leadership can be on every level, and just because you're not got the title of a foreman or a subforeman or a GF, doesn't mean that you're not a leader.
Absolutely, but we need to also teach leadership skills anytime, you know, for everybody.
Yeah, 100%.
You know, this is what leadership is about. This is how you demonstrate leadership. And yeah, you don't have to be the supervisor.
I always say you could have a group of groundmen. You could have a group of grunts, in a yard working, and one person in that group is going to come out as the leader of that group.
People naturally evolve. It's a natural human process. Some, you know, anytime you have a group, everybody looks around and says, "Okay, so who's going to get it started?" And you'll have people who want to lead, and they'll jump in there and take control. And they may not necessarily be the right person either, right? So part of the challenge of all organizations is to find those good leaders at every level in the organization, and to develop that, foster that leadership, develop that trust, build those relationships, give that reinforcement. That's a tough one. Yeah. It doesn't happen easily.
It's a tough one, too, I think, because it feeds into ego. It can feed into ego. And so on the receiving end, to receive, but to receive without it feeding an ego is...
We're not going to get into ego today because we don't have enough time.
Yeah.
Everybody has an ego, and everyone needs that ego stroked in some way.
Sure.
But they're all a little different.
Yeah.
I know what you're getting at.
Yeah.
And again, we have to manage those egos. That's part of the challenge of any organization, right?
I guess that's what I meant.
You have to manage all these issues, and that's a key. You spoke about a group of people. Any group of people getting together for a common purpose will look to someone to lead them.
Yeah.
It's naturally how we operate. We are hierarchical in our nature. There's a lot of things that, a lot of reasons for that. In today's world, a lot of people don't want to step forward because they don't want to take the risk. Right? Like, okay, I'll let Ryan do that and stick his neck out.
Yeah, for sure.
And if he gets his head cut off, then I know I made the right decision. But then, you know, so Ryan steps up, takes the risk, and gets the reward. Then the person sitting back says, "So why does he deserve that?"
Yeah, that was my idea.
So it's that. It's a tough one. It's it's about managing people and process and system. And there are some fundamental things that we need to change about how we do that. We've touched on a lot of really good issues. We've touched on the issue of compliance. We've touched on the issue of blame. We've touched on the issue of skill and performance. These are all critical issues in today's environment. And in order to create the best environment we can, I'm gonna say this. I want our linemen, everyone, whether you're an apprentice, you're a journeyman, you're a foreman, you're a GF, it doesn't matter. We need to build those trust relationships so that we can talk about stuff, so that we can talk about stuff with each other, so that when something happens, we can learn from it. Those so-called near-miss things, in my career, almost, I would say 90% of the events that I've investigated were near misses. They weren't serious accidents. And we learned tremendously from those near misses because nobody's been hurt. No major losses occurred. But we know we've had a breakdown in system or process or something. And we figure it out and then learn from it. Yep. And if we do that, we're going to move forward in leaps and bounds. Right now, Quanta's looking at how do we stop fatalities? That's how you stop fatalities.
Yeah.
You learn. Yep. You look at those near misses. You understand them thoroughly. Get the most out of them that you can. And then move forward.
Yeah.
And we'll get there.
Yeah, for sure we will. Thanks, Jim.
It's been a pleasure.
I really appreciate you being on. Thanks.